Hello there, Drew Hanisch of Whiskey Lore, and time for another whiskey tasting. And today I am doing a tasting of a whiskey that I purchased on my recent trip to Kentucky and Tennessee. And of course, I always come back with a Scotch or an Irish whiskey, or Canadian whiskey, or something other than bourbon. Or I did come back with some bourbons and some ryes, but I came back with this, which is Airstone. And I actually bought this as the last thing that I bought when I was coming back. This is from William Grant & Sons. It's part of Bracketology, and people were saying nice things about it. So I said, $31 a bottle, it's worth a shot. Now, there's not a lot on the bottle or the packaging that tells you much about where this comes from and the rest. Well, it comes from Ailsa Bay Distillery, which is in Ayrshire, Scotland. I don't have my little map around. Or do I? Oh, I do. Here, I'll show you where it's at. So it's in the lowlands. So there are more lowland distilleries coming about. And it's right down in this particular area of the lowlands down here. So south of Glasgow. And interesting that they want to be a peated style whiskey distillery. And when I think of the lowlands, I don't normally think of peated. So interesting. William Grant & Sons, you think of Balvenie, you think of Glenfiddich, you think of Tullamore Dew are all part of the William Grant family. And now you have Ailsa Bay and this Airstone whiskey, which comes in two different types, sea cask and land cask. And this one is supposed to be the smooth version. 40% ABV. I almost didn't buy it because of that. I want a little more flavor, but I decided to give it a shot, especially at $31, to see what I thought about it. And the distillery has been around since 2007. It's supposed to be a state-of-the-art distillery. It's interesting that they put 1887 on the bottle as the date, which I'm going to assume, I should know this, I'm going to assume that's William Grant & Sons' date, not the date of, or maybe it has some relationship to Airstone. I don't know, because it doesn't say anything on the bottle to let me know. When I brought this home, I tasted it, and you'll see, I mean, there's a really good dent out of that whiskey. But you might be surprised to find that the dent in the whiskey is not necessarily because of the whiskey itself. Confused? Okay, let me dig in. First, I'm going to do a nosing and tasting on this thing. When I first did my first nosing and tasting on this whiskey, I wasn't overly impressed. Again, I was going 40% ABV. It had flavor to it. Nothing was jumping out. I needed time to relax and really take it in, because at first glance, first taste, this one may come across, may disarm you a little bit, because it has a lot of minerally notes to it. It is definitely not a fruity whiskey, but it's not an overly, it's not a peated whiskey either, as far as I know, or if it is peated, then there's some smoke in there, but I don't know that it's peated, because they say the land cask is a peated, and I see nothing about peated on this label. But if you're a peated fan, you're probably going to like this a little bit more than somebody who is not a peated whiskey fan. So there is a cinnamon baking spice thing going on with this thing, with a very minerally character, a little bit of salt. Underneath, you sense a little bit of a, like an apple, but it's so buried that it's really hard to pick out. Like I say, this is a whiskey that a lot of people may taste or smell and go, okay, I don't know, what is that? Is that really whiskey? Because it has flavors and scents that would throw you off. But that same thing's going to happen with peated whiskey if you're not a peated whiskey fan. Cheers. A little sawdust in there too, I think. So on the palate, it has this really nice butterscotch flavor coming through. Toffee slash butterscotch. Something about this reminds me of waffles. And I think it's just a grain note that's coming through in there. But then it kind of goes a little bitter. It's not aggressive bitter, but it's like a citrus peel bitter that comes in on the finish. And a little of that brininess comes through. That little salt character hits you on the finish. It's probably on the nose too, mixing with that sawdust a little bit. It's a 10-year-old whiskey. But I'll tell you why this bottle got a dent in it. When I was sort of unsatisfied the first time I tasted it, I said, okay. And this is why I asked the question. I asked this question on Twitter. I said, what do you do with a whiskey that you determine you don't really like so much? And do you blend it? Or what do you do with it? You know? And this was the case with one of these. Spilled all over the place, of course. My table's going to have a nice little white scar on it. So I decided to take some rye and put it in it and see what would happen. And I tried it first with the J.W. Kelly Golden Age rye, and it's really, really nice. Then I took some Ragtime rye, tried it with that. Turned out really, really nice. And then I said, you know, I got this big bottle of Wild Turkey 101 rye, and you guys might like it. As ryes go, it's not one of my favorites. There's not anything really wrong with it. It just isn't one that I go reaching for. But let me tell you, add a little of this into there, and it does not take a lot. And let it marry up a little bit. And nose it. And now the sawdust has come through a little bit more, along with a little herbally rye note on top. It freshens the nose, is what it does. Maybe brings out more of like a fresh lemon kind of a note. Cheers. It softens the whiskey. Ooh, lemon drop. The rye notes are there. That toffee butterscotch is mellowed down a little bit. Mixes wonderfully with that rye note. And then it finishes really nice because it finishes with a rye note. But it's a soft rye note. It took that kind of citrus rind and turned it more into a fruit rather than being the wrapping of the fruit. And so really impressive. And I get a little bit of mint chocolate chip on the palate as well, which is really, really nice. And actually, after you've sipped your third one, the mint chocolate chip is what really stands out on this. It kind of kills off the sea character a bit, but it just mixes so, so nicely. So if we say a mint chocolate chip with a little brininess to it, it's actually a really, really nice mix. And one thing I'll say for the Airstone is that it has a nice bit of body to it, even though it's 40% ABV. Well distilled. I just, like I say, on its own, I'm kind of indifferent to it. But man, put a little rye whiskey in it, and I really, really like it. This whiskey, very tasty, very tasty, right up my alley. You guys tell me, do you, when you have a bottle of whiskey and it's just not hitting you right, does it sit in the back of the cabinet forever? Or do you throw it to an infinity bottle? Or do you blend? What's your thing to do when you get a whiskey that you're kind of like, you know what, I'm probably not going to drink that very much. Not to say it's bad, but to say, it's just not a whiskey. There's so many other whiskeys I could go grab. Why would I grab that particular one? And have you ever had an experiment that turned out really, really good with two whiskeys you blend? I did Wild Turkey 101 at one point with Glendronach 12. Not two whiskeys that I would be tossing away. They are favorites, but together, they made a really interesting whiskey. So anyway, hope you enjoyed the video. If you did, give me a like, subscribe. If you've watched this for the first time and you're like, that guy's weird, I think I should watch him a little bit more. And until next time, cheers and slánce vá. Nice. Really nice.